Good evening. Welcome to Apostasy Alert. I'm your host, Jackie Alnor, and what I'd like to do tonight is play a portion of an interview that I did over the phone with Brittney Koper, the granddaughter of the founders of the Trinity Broadcasting Network, Jan and Paul Crouch, who is involved in all this litigation back and forth over her trying to bring TBN into some state of accountability. As many of you know, because not only have I talked about it, but it's been in the news for quite a while now, is that Brittney was working at TBN as the chief financial officer and found so many wrong things in the books that she just, you know, had to bring them to account for, and they would have no accountability to her or anyone else. And so, of course, she became their enemy, and they terminated her. And not only did they fire her, but they also fired her father, Paul Crouch Jr., who was almost single-handedly running the network for quite some time because of the feebleness of his father, Paul Crouch. And also, as we're going to find out, even her brother Brandon was let go after Brittney filed her lawsuits against a couple of TBN lawyers that had been working on behalf of TBN to help cover up the dirty business going on behind the scenes. You know, you've heard me speak for so long against the heresies and the evil claims of the prosperity gospel and the abuse and the fleecing of the sheep of God. And I've been talking about those things for so long, and yet for years I've been hearing rumors of some of the most vile wickedness one can imagine against the Crouch family, Jan and Paul and Matthew Crouch as well. And you know, and I haven't reported on that much because I just felt it had to be, those things had to be confirmed by more than one witness. Now, as far as I'm concerned, Brittney is the second witness of these, to see these events firsthand. The first witness being Kelly Whitmore back in around 2005, when she was the assistant of Jan Crouch, and she came forward with a lot of information that was, quite frankly, so shocking that it came close to being unbelievable that I was concerned about reporting it back then. Even when I wrote my book, The Fleecing of Christianity, I left out all of those rumors of Jan's promiscuity and Paul Crouch's bent towards same-sex attraction and all of these horror stories and the thugs that they would use to intimidate people, all of things like this. I just dealt with what I could see and document on Christian television, as I've been documenting it and taping it for 25 years now. So I didn't want to touch those things, but now that the second witness and even more viable witness has come forward, Brittney Koper, I think I can freely speak on some of these things because we already know that the Crouch's theology is corrupt. But any time doctrine is false, so is the morality of the people who are proclaiming it. That just seems to be a given. And now we know from her testimony as a second witness that these things are reliable. Until just recently, Brittney was under a court restraining order put on her by TBN not to speak to anybody about them or anything, and then when it lifted, it gave us the opportunity to talk freely. She won't be talking about the details of the court case, but she will speak, as you will hear, just about the interaction in her family and the different things going on behind the scenes. Now, I found Brittney to be intelligent, articulate, and a highly educated woman. She has a master's degree. She's very brave to do what she is doing. And people who have accused her of being after the money, they have nothing to stand on, considering the fact that she was in a very high position at TBN and was positioned to where she could live like the king and queens that they live. But she chose truth rather than to go along with their sin and to be an accomplice to the crime they've done against the body of Christ. So without further ado, here's Brittney.
I'm doing the right thing. Like, this is the right thing to do. And that's why I'm able to continue doing it. You know, despite the rash of lawsuits and all these, flying accusations, and, every day being another, sparring match with, my family. So, it's a long road, but I'm definitely in it for the long haul. I'm certainly not doing this to try and, quote unquote, get a big payday. Like, everybody's like, oh, she just wants a payday. And it's like, no, believe me, there are easier things in life to do in order to earn a living. And I'm really doing this to, I think the world needs to know. I really think that, I really feel convicted to tell the truth and to stand up for what's right. TBN has bullied so many people over the past 30 years, they've gotten away with it because they are scary people. They're terrifying, and they have endless funds to continue their reign of terror. And they've been able to intimidate people and, scare them into keeping quiet and spend money on attorney's fees to get them to keep their mouth shut. And unfortunately for them, I'm not easily intimidated, and that's not going to happen.
Who do you see?
I'm
sorry. Who do you see as the biggest, as the one calling these shots to be intimidating to people, of your relatives?
Well, right now I really see it as my Uncle Matt. He's a very vengeful person. And this is personal for him. I quote unquote blew the whistle on, many of the illegal things that were happening in regards to his income. Like, for example, his income was not reported on their 990s. And that was one of the things I was bringing up and going, what's going on here? The hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of payments to his for-profit company, which were not properly recorded on their TBN's 990s and are legally required to do so. So he has it out for me. This is a personal vendetta that he is waging against me. And he and my grandmother have a very interesting relationship, a very close relationship. And so she's supporting him, and there you have it. There's two members of the board of directors of the three, so it's a majority of the board. I also feel like it's TBN's general counsel, John Casoria. He's calling a lot of these shots. He's their general counsel. If TBN were doing something that were not in the best interest of TBN, it's his job to speak up and say otherwise. And, he's not. He's continuing down this road, and the further they go, the more they're going to be exposed, and that's fine with me, because that's what I'm trying to do anyway. My grandparents have not spoken to me or really anybody in my family since October. It's very odd, it's like I'm dead to them, and at first it was very hurtful, because I was very close to my grandmother, especially when I was in high school and college. And for some reason, she just totally cut me out of her life. And, I've reached out to her, called her, we used to exchange text messages all the time, and, I love you, Grandma. And Thanksgiving was definitely very, very hard for me. It was a very emotional day. Just because it was the first Thanksgiving, I haven't had my grandmother's stuffing and just silly stuff like that. And it was devastating, really, And then Christmas came and went, and I was the only person in my family. My grandmother didn't, she bought everybody these personalized Bibles. They're actually very beautiful. But she bought everybody in my family a personalized Bible for Christmas, but I didn't get one. And I sent her a text message on Christmas Day, and I said, I love you so much, Grandma, no matter what. Thank you so much for teaching me about Jesus. And I haven't received any reply. So yeah. I stopped trying. I figured, she would contact me when and if she was ever ready. My birthday came and went. I didn't hear anything. It was the first year in 27 years I didn't receive balloons on my birthday from my grandma.
But can you confirm that Jan and Paul haven't been together as a married couple in quite some time?
I know ever since I was a little girl, they never lived together. So, what goes on behind closed doors, I can't really testify to because I was never around that. But I do know that it was always Grandma had her house and Papa had his house, and that's just the way it was. And I never really asked questions. It's just the way it always has been. I feel like I'm doing the right thing. This is the right thing to do. They've been getting away with a lot of things that need to be exposed, that are not only illegal but absolutely unconscionable. And enough is enough. It's just, where does it end? So, if they want to, continue to make threats against me, that's their prerogative. I love them no matter what. I always will. If I saw my grandma tomorrow, I'd run up to her and give her a hug and tell her how much I loved her and I've missed her. So I really, I really hold no grudges. But at the same time, I'm not going to give in to something that is, in my mind, an injustice.
Can you confirm that Matthew Crouch is not Paul Crouch's biological offspring?
I haven't seen paternity test results or anything like that, but I do know, I can say that I have had conversations with my grandmother on more than one occasion when we were out together or having dinner together. One of the conversations was in her house in Orlando. But, she's admitted to me and others more than once that Matthew is the product of an affair she had with Mr. America in 1954. His name was Dick Dubois.
Do you think that's why she is more partial to Matthew, because of his paternity?
Absolutely. Yes. I think Matthew is, from what she's told me, he's her love child. And that's why he's been able to get away with, so much of this, cutting corners and contract to produce, million-dollar movies. There's no way they would have agreed to do that if my dad, with my dad's production company, and he had a production company for a long time that did not do any work for TBN. And she's protecting her love child, for lack of a better word.
Do you think that Paul Sr. knows about this?
No, absolutely not.
You don't think he knows that that's not his true son?
I don't think. If he does, he's in denial about it. My grandparents, they live in their own reality. They kind of make up their own rules, what they want to believe. If he was made aware of it at some point, he's completely blocked that out. They're very narcissistic people, obviously. They live in their own reality. They make up their own rules. And clearly, for the last 30 years, not even the laws have applied to them. So, why wouldn't they make that comparison? There's been nobody there that's been able to or willing to hold them accountable to any sort of standards, guidelines for anything they do. So it certainly doesn't surprise me that she would make a statement like that.
How does Jen respond to people who do make fun of her for crazy wigs and her eyelashes and the way she dresses?
She they're all evil. They're all of the devil and whatever.
She doesn't see something wrong. She doesn't look in the mirror and say, "Eesh, this isn't a good reputation."
I asked that one time. I was having a conversation with my dad. I was just like, "Dad, like, what's the deal? I mean, really, like, it takes her 2 hours to get dressed. Why does she look like that?" And my dad's just kind of like, I don't really know. But he said, but it's been like a progression. He said, if she would have walked in looking the way she does now, 15 years ago, we all would have gone, "Oh my gosh, what happened?" But it was kind of a slow progression into what it is now. And people will always go, "Oh, your grandma looks like Tammy Faye," and I'm like going, "Tammy Faye? Tammy Faye looks normal to me." granted, she wore smile, eyeliner and eyelashes, but how do you even compare the two? I mean, it's just.
And the way she is responsible for the horrible decorations of, like, the Bear Avenue place particularly looks like cheap French brothel. How do people walk through there with a straight face, I guess? It's hard for me to fathom.
You know, I don't know. It's kind of like stepping into an alter universe, you know. It's like you kind of go there to be entertained and to see everything, and then it's like, okay, let's get back into reality again and, you know, move on with our lives. But it's, you know, it's for show, and it is what it is, I guess. And my brother is actually, he's working at a church in Santa Monica right now, as part of, you know, the retaliation against me. Of course, they fired him, and he and his wife went up to Santa Monica, and they're actually doing great. He's working for a church up there, and helping my dad out at the Word Network. And
what was the timing of when they let him go?
Right, like around the same time they let my dad go, probably in October of 2011.
How did he feel?
Everybody was just very confused about everything, and he's hurt. You know, he's hurt because at the end of the day, these people, just your grandmother and your uncle and your grandfather, and for some reason they won't speak to him, and he's like going, well, like what? Like you know, I don't understand, and none of us really understand, to be honest. It's really sad, and there's no reason for it. You know, we've been blessed with good health and time, and it's definitely time that could be spent together as a family, and for some reason that's not happening.
Yeah. What about this Jesus character at the Holy Land experience? I saw on the behind the scenes. So see, I watched the show. Like I said, you don't.
Yeah.
And she was doing this whole tour behind the scenes, arm in arm with this guy, like snuggling with him through this whole thing. It was like shocking how indiscreet it was. Do you have any insights into that?
Oh, absolutely. You know, it was. Yeah, it was very bizarre to me because, you know, when I would go visit my grandmother in Orlando, you know, he was always around, and they would hold hands and walk together, and you know, I witnessed them, you know, snuggling, exchanging kisses, and I'm like going, what in the world? and you know, I asked her about it. I said, Grandma, what are you doing? And she said, oh, I kiss everybody on the lips. And I said, what? She said, yeah, you know, I kiss everybody on the lips. It's not a big deal. It doesn't mean anything. And it's like, I don't know. It made me very, very uncomfortable.
Does he,
I can say that.
What's his name?
His name is Les.
Yeah.
And he's actually, it's very sad because, you know, he's got a beautiful wife and three beautiful children. And you know, here he is, you know, clearly having an inappropriate relationship with my grandmother. And, you know, he doesn't leave her side. It's like she travels somewhere, she takes less with her. Both my grandparents do drink alcohol on a regular basis. My grandfather, unfortunately, has a horrible addiction to alcohol that has really deteriorated his brain. You know, he's just not the person he used to be. You know, he definitely has difficulty remembering things on an hour-to-hour basis, if not day-to-day basis, which made, you know, your job there at the company, you know, very difficult when, you know, he tells you to do something and the next day he's like, why the heck did you do this?
Oh.
And then you just kind of go, wait a minute, you told me to.
Oh,
and, you know, I did not. And it's like, oh my gosh. I really love my grandfather and I really miss him a lot. I think that he's been so manipulated by my grandmother that you know, he's not mentally sharp, and so he's easily controlled by fear. He's easily manipulated into believing things that maybe not necessarily aren't true. And you know, regardless of any personal downfalls he may have or things he's struggling with in his life, you know, I really miss him. Like I always felt like I had a special connection to him, and I really love him a lot. And I hope to someday, you know, at least have a relationship to be his granddaughter again, because he's pretty funny. You know, he tells some really funny stories, I think that's definitely what I miss the most about being in California. You know, nothing would make me happier than to see TBN in the hands of somebody who would run it properly and do right by the employees and really make it a wonderful thing, you know, spreading hope and inspiration instead of, you know, prosperity gospel and hopefully, you know, God willing, that'll happen someday. I remember one year I was in personnel and I fought to have my grandpa, the holiday fell on kind of a funny day where Christmas Day was going to be on Friday and so Christmas Eve was going to be on Thursday. So I asked my grandfather if it'd be okay to allow the employees to have Christmas Eve off as well as a holiday, and he reluctantly agreed eventually, and then, you know, my grandma found out about it and was so angry with me, and called my grandfather all upset because, you know, TBN would be losing so much money if we gave the employees the day off, and so my grandfather ended up canceling. He granted it as a holiday, and then at the last minute, on, you know, December 23rd at 3 p.m. sends an email out to all the employees saying, Christmas Eve is canceled as a holiday. You all need to come to the office.
Oh,
and it
no.
was just like, oh, my gosh.
Oh,
like I felt so bad. I wanted to crawl under the table.
Oh, that's horrible.
Yeah. And so it's just, you know, it's just stuff like that. But it's just like, it wouldn't have really cost them anything. You know, it's a soft cost to give that day off so people can spend time with their families. And of course, you know, they ended up taking it away at the last minute. And, you know, I don't know. My grandparents just, they see employees as a liability. I heard one person put it very, honestly and truthfully when he said, you know, like, Jan treats her dogs better than she does her employees. And to be honest, it's true. I would always joke with my grandma and go, you know, if I could do it all over again, I'd ask God if I could just come back as one of your dogs.
Because,
oh, you know, feeding them, you know, leftover filet mignon and all this other wonderful stuff.
Have you ever thought of telling your grandfather the situation with the Matthew Krauts thing? Because believe me, that is the most shocking
thing
of all.
I've tried. They have him locked down. I mean, not even my dad can get a hold of him. So, and I'm like going, Dad, you know, please, somebody needs to tell him. And not even my dad can get a hold of my grandfather. So, you know, my grandmother and my uncle have been so surrounded and inaccessible to anybody else in the family, I think, to keep him in the dark about a lot of this.
Oh, it seems like he's the biggest sucker. You know what I mean? It just seems that way. Oh.
Very naive. Very naive.
Yeah.
But, you know, my grandmother, she really puts it on. You know, she's, oh, honey, I love you. And it's like, you know, I don't know. I was deceived for a long time too. You know, I thought my grandmother was just the most incredible person in the world, and you know, she doesn't even talk to me anymore. So, you know, I don't know.
Well,
she's very talented.
Do you think that there will be people that could end up, once this thing all plays out, that could end up in?
Well,
I
do know that the Orange County District Attorney's Office and the U.S. Attorney have deployed a joint task force to, you know, do an investigation, and I have been cooperating with them, and I will continue to cooperate with them as they work through the process to see, you know, what they feel, you know, what crimes have been committed, and to hold, I guess, the responsible parties accountable.
If you just tuned in, that was an interview I was having on the phone last night with Brittney Koper, the granddaughter of Paul and Jan Crouch of the Trinity Broadcasting Network. I apologize for the bad quality of sound, for the telephone was just making a hum or something, and it just couldn't be avoided. But anyway, I would like to summarize what we learned. This is a very shocking testimony. Some of the things we learned was that Paul and Jan have not lived together as a couple in decades, that their relationship on the air is a sham, that Matthew Crouch is the product of adultery and not Paul Crouch's biological son. Jan, still in her old age, is in an adulterous relationship. Paul Sr. is a drunk.
Radio.
Jan and Paul are tyrants as bosses over at TBN. And it was interesting to learn that the U.S. Attorney's Office is investigating for potential criminal action upon not only the Crouches, but also the other relative, John Cassoria, possibly, and of course, Matthew Crouch, and who knows how far it can spread. All I know is that this is another scandal, like we've had so much in the recent past, that has turned even the world's view of Christianity into disrepute. I'd like to read a portion of a commentary that was written by a TBN employee who must remain anonymous, or he will lose his job if anyone there at TBN knows that he supports Brittney. He said, God raised Esther up for a specific purpose at a specific time. We all know the story. It is written in the pages of the Bible. But maybe God is doing something now, something similar, something significant, right before our eyes, and we are missing it. Maybe Brittney Crouch Koper is a modern-day Esther. Who else could be brought into the inner circle, see the things no one was meant to see, and told to play the game? But then something happened which nobody expected. She refused to be corrupted. She has sacrificed money, reputation, status, and family to take a stand for what is right. Could it be that God has placed her there for such a time as this? No ministry becomes corrupt overnight. It is a process which takes time. Little decisions, little compromises, and then the slippery slope to decline. During this decline, where have been the mighty men of God? Where have been the prophets? Where have been those that would speak up and stand for what is right? Has everyone been blinded, or have they just winked at what they saw and heard? In his wisdom, God raised up a young woman to say no. Well, is this comparable to the story of Esther? It seems that Esther was trying to save her people, and I think that things have gone too far now, that the enemy seems to have won this battle against Christianity, really, by raising up TBN to this extent in spreading error and in showing Christianity in a false light. And so I'm not as optimistic as that man. I don't see that TBN can be used as a vessel of honor for God's purposes when it has, from the beginning, seems to have been a vessel of dishonor that has been used by the enemy to corrupt even the image of Christianity globally. However, like Esther, Brittney is certainly God's chosen vessel to bring the hidden things of darkness to the light. So please keep her in prayer, and until next week, keep on the lookout.